Hello, Zaire. Time for part two from the Just So Stories of Rudyard Kipling, part two of The Butterfly Who Stamped. Do you remember the story? Do you remember what's going on? Do you remember Suleiman bin Daud the Great and Wise, Suleiman bin Daud and his 999 wives? Do you remember his favorite wife, the beautiful Queen Balkis? Do you remember the two butterflies, the husband and wife, and the wife is always quarreling? Kinda like the 999 wives are always quarreling. There's a plan afoot here. Do you remember that the butterfly, the male, the man, the husband butterfly, boasted to his wife that if he stamped his foot, he could make Suleiman bin Daud's palace disappear? That's where we are. That's where we are in the story. This is the butterfly's wife speaking to her husband.
It wouldn't matter if you did, said his wife. You couldn't bend a blade of grass with your stamping. I dare you to do it, she said. Stamp, stamp, stamp.
Suleiman bin Daud, sitting under the camphor tree, heard every word of this, and he laughed as he had never laughed in his life before. He forgot all about his queens. He forgot about the animal that came out of the sea. He forgot about showing off. He just laughed with joy. And Balkis, on the other side of the tree, smiled because her own true love was so joyful. Presently, the butterfly, very hot and puffy, came whirling back under the shadow of the camphor tree and said to Suleiman,
"She wants me to stamp. She wants to see what will happen. Oh, Suleiman bin Daud, you know that I can't do it, and now she'll never believe me. She'll laugh at me to the end of my days."
"No, little brother," said Suleiman bin Daud. "She will never laugh at you again." And he turned the ring on his finger. Just for the sake of the butterfly, not for the sake of showing off. And lo and behold, four huge jinns came out of the earth.
"Slaves," said Suleiman bin Daud, "when this gentleman on my finger stamps his left front forefoot, you will make my palace and these gardens disappear in a clap of thunder. When he stamps again, you will bring them back carefully. Now, little brother," he said, "go back to your wife and stamp all you've a mind to."
Away flew the butterfly to his wife, who was crying,
"I dare you to do it. I dare you to do it. Stamp, stamp now. Stamp!"
Balkis saw the four vast jinns swoop down to the four corners of the gardens with the palace in the middle, and she clasped her hands softly and said,
"At last Suleiman bin Daud will do for the sake of a butterfly what he ought to have done long ago for his own sake, and the quarrelsome queens will be frightened."
Then the butterfly stamped. The jinns jerked the palace and the gardens 1,000 miles into the air, and there was a most awful thunderclap, and everything grew inky black. The butterfly's wife fluttered about in the dark, crying,
"Oh, I'll be good. I'm so sorry I spoke. Only bring the gardens back, my dear darling husband. I'll never contradict again."
The butterfly was nearly as frightened as his wife, and Suleiman bin Daud laughed so much that it was several minutes before he found breath enough to whisper to the butterfly,
"Stamp again, little brother. Give me back my palace, O most great magician."
"Yes, give him back his palace,"
said the butterfly's wife, still flying about in the dark like a moth.
"Give him back his palace, and don't let's have any more horrid magic."
"Well, my dear," said the butterfly as bravely as he could, "you see what your nagging has led to? Of course, it doesn't make any difference to me. I'm used to this kind of thing. But as a favor to you and to Suleiman bin Daud, I don't mind putting things right." So he stamped once more, and that instant the djinns let down the palace and the gardens, even without a bump. The sun shone on the dark green-orange leaves, the fountains played among the pink Egyptian lilies, the birds went on singing, and the butterfly's wife lay on her side under the camphor tree, waggling her wings and panting,
"Oh, I'll be good. I'll be good."
Suleiman bin Daud could hardly speak for laughing. He leaned back all weak and hiccoughy and shook his finger at the butterfly and said,
"Oh, great wizard, what is the sense of returning me my palace if at the same time you slay me with mirth?"
Then came a terrible noise, for all the 999 queens came running out of the palace, shrieking and shouting and calling for their babies. They hurried down the great marble steps below the fountain, 100 abreast, and the most wise Balkas went stately forward to meet them and said,
"What is your trouble, O queens?"
They stood on the marble steps, 100 abreast, and shouted,
"What is our trouble? We are living peacefully in our golden palace, as is our custom, when upon a sudden the palace disappeared, and we were left sitting in the thick and noisome darkness, and it thundered, and djinns and efforts moved about in the darkness. That is our trouble, O head queen. We are most extremely troubled on account of that trouble, for it was a troublesome trouble, unlike any trouble we have ever known."
Then Balkas, the most beautiful queen, Suleiman bin Daud's very best beloved, queen that was of Sheba and Sabi and the towers of Zin and the sands of Zimbabwe, Balkas, almost as wise as the most wise Suleiman bin Daud himself, said,
"It is nothing, O queens. A butterfly has made a complaint against his wife because she quarreled with him, and it has pleased our lord Suleiman bin Daud to teach her a lesson in low speaking and humbleness, for it is counted a virtue among the wives of the butterflies."
Then up and spoke an Egyptian queen, the daughter of a pharaoh, and she said,
"Our palace cannot be plucked up by the roots like a leek for the sake of a little insect. No, Suleiman bin Daud must be dead, and what we heard and saw was the earth thundering and darkening at the news."
Then Balkas beckoned that bold queen without looking at her, and said to her and to the others,
"Come and see."
They came down the marble steps, 100 abreast, and beneath his camphor tree, still weak with laughing, they saw the most wise King Suleiman bin Daud rocking back and forth with a butterfly on either hand, and they heard him say,
"Oh, wife of my brother in the air, remember after this to please your husband in all things, lest he be provoked to stamp his foot yet again, for he has said that he is used to this magic, and he is most eminently a great magician, one who steals away the very palace of Suleiman bin Daud himself. Go in peace, little folk."
And they kissed them on the wings, and they flew away. Then all the queens except Balkas, the most beautiful and splendid Balkas, who stood apart, smiling, they all fell flat on their faces, for they said,
"If these things are done when a butterfly is displeased with his wife, what shall be done to us, who have vexed our king with our loud speaking and opening quarreling too many days?"
They put their veils over their heads, and they put their hands over their mouths, and they tiptoed back to the palace, most mousy quiet. Then Balkas, the most beautiful and excellent Balkas, went forward through the red lilies into the shade of the camphor tree and laid her hand upon Suleiman bin Daud's shoulder and said,
"Oh, my lord and treasure of my soul, rejoice, for we have taught the queens of Egypt and Ethiopia and Abyssinia and Persia and India and China with a great and memorable teaching."
And Suleiman bin Daud, still looking after the butterflies where they played in the sunlight, said,
"Oh, my lady, and jewel of my felicity, when did this happen? For I have been jesting with a butterfly ever since I came into the garden." And he told Balkas what he had done.
Balkas, the tender and most lovely Balkas, said,
"Oh, my lord and regent of my existence, I hid behind the camphor tree and saw it all. It was I who told the butterfly's wife to ask the butterfly to stamp, because I'd hoped that for the sake of a jest, my lord would make some great magic, and that the queens would see it and be frightened.
And she told him what the queens had said and seen and thought. Then Suleiman bin Daud rose up from his seat under the camphor tree and stretched his arms and rejoiced and said, "O my lady and sweetener of my days, know that if I had made a magic against my queens for the sake of pride or anger, as I made that feast for the animals, I should certainly have been put to shame. But by means of your wisdom, I made the magic for the sake of a jest and for the sake of a little butterfly. And behold, it delivered me also from the vexations of my vexatious wives. Tell me, therefore, O lady, and heart of my heart, how did you come to be so wise?" And Balkis, the queen, beautiful and tall, looked up into Suleiman bin Daud's eyes and put her head a little on one side, just like the butterfly, and said,
"First, O my lord, because I loved you, and secondly, O my lord, because I know what women folk are like."
They went up to the palace and lived happily ever after. But wasn't it clever of Balkis?